Welcome to episode 57 of the Time Talks podcast, part of the Channel Zero Network. This was a special episode recorded live at Meet Me Info Cafe in Denver with Dr. Joy James. In this episode, we discussed Dr. James' new book, In Pursuit of Revolutionary Love, Precarity, Power, Communities. I'm grateful to have a chapter in this book as well with Dr. James, which was a past episode we did together. The link to the book is in the show notes. Thank you to Awareness for the music. And here's a brief jingle from a fellow Channel Zero Network member.
Where did you get this?
Your friendly neighborhood anarchist.
More of an anarchist militant.
People involved in social struggles than everybody else.
People have been waiting for some content.
Radio and show.
The final straw, and I'm William Gooding.
And I'm Percy Goodness.
The final straw radio.noblog.org.
If you're listening, you are the resistance.
In part one of your book, In Pursuit of Revolutionary Love, Precarity, Power, and Communities, you start the book with Precarity, which are essays by you, and then you go into the different other themes of the book. Can you talk about some of the main themes of these essays and how you organize the book?
Yeah, so the book is divided into three sections. Those are the subtitles: Precarity, Community, Power and Communities. And so the first part of the book, those are essays. And actually, they're developed over a number of years, unlike the podcast. Like the podcast pretty much were happening during COVID, right? Everybody was pretty much locked down. There wasn't a lot to do. I actually hadn't done many podcasts until COVID happened. And then people wanted to talk and you couldn't really travel to talk or be in community. So we start these discussions. And also had published Airbrushing Revolution for the Sake of Abolition. And that had come, you know, during the time of the COVID lockdown as well. And so that shapes some of the essays in the first part of Precarities, but also some of that work, I began to write it after the protest in 2014, 2015. So if you date back some of those essays, even though they got revised or updated, they were really looking at, I would say 2014 was critical, even though Trayvon Martin, you know, was killed a couple of years earlier. And then the acquittal of George Zimmerman, you know, kind of tipped things off in a much more public way. It was the year 2014, because it would have been the killing of Eric Gardner on a Staten Island street by Daniel Pantaleo, and he didn't choke him out or do chest compression, you know, as one individual. There were a whole collective of police officers taking him down. That means down to the sidewalk and then, you know, pinning him down and basically suffocating him. Also in 2014, there was the killing of Michael Brown by Darren Wilson, right, in Ferguson, Missouri. And so that becomes like one of the so-called hot spots. So if you look at, you know, maps of war, you see all the red dots, right, where things are kind of lit up. These killings themselves kind of registered as internal colony or Black communities that are under-resourced as being preyed upon and victimized, you know, by police forces. So first it would have been Eric Gardner, I believe. Then it would have been Michael Brown. And the last person, and actually a child, would have been Tamir Rice, the 12-year-old in Ohio. So you have New York State, you have Missouri, and you have Ohio. And it's, I don't know what rapid succession of death and police murders, you know, what kind of language to use, but the sequencing, it was just building up the tension, building up the protests, building up the rebellions. I did not go to Missouri, to Ferguson. Some of my students did. I did not go to Ohio, but later I would work with Samaria Rice. And most recently, February 8th, she was on a roundtable that we hosted at the college with Don Wooten, who's a whistleblower on the so-called womb collector, the forced hysterectomies of women, reproductive teenage girls, and ICE camps. Joyce McMillan, who seeks for the abolition of foster care as we know it, because it's a predatory monetary scheme. And then the last person is Amanda Wallace, who's in North Carolina, who left her job as a social worker once she realized the corruption and the damage done to families, particularly Black and Brown families, impoverished families. those four were in a round table. So through those three tragedies, I was able to understand better the violence that's arrayed against communities, but democracy writ large, right, in the U.S. And I was living in Harlem. Like I said, I wasn't in Missouri. I wasn't in Ohio, but I was in New York State. And so when I was living in Harlem, I could hear the protests under my windows. And sometimes, you know, I'd go out and try to get kids to come with me to march. You know, sometimes they want to, sometimes they don't. But so New York City was the ground that I stood on to better understand, or to think I better understood, what was going on in Missouri and what was going on in Ohio, not just in terms of victimization, but also in terms of resistance and rebellion. And so that those essays, those early essays, the one about revolutionary love resists democracy, which is chapter one, that actually is just, you know, it's recent writing. But the other ones about the talented 10th, the other ones about abolition, the ones that talk about, you know, a revised essay on airbrushing revolution for the sake of abolition, the distrust of academia's role in leadership, because academia is not a revolutionary formation, it's an anti-revolutionary formation. Now, these are the things that I was working out. Now, two chapters are co-authored by a colleague, comrade of mine, who I've known for 30 years, and that's Kim Holder, who was in the Harlem branch of the Black Panther Party. And through Holder, you know, if I traveled and I went to Cuba, other places, I can meet people who trained him, right? And the way in which we write these two chapters, I'm not trying to, maybe those two chapters are maybe the most, quote, upbeat, because there's a strategy in those two chapters that are co-authored by Holder, because we're using his dissertation that he did decades ago. They're the first two dissertations, rather, by Black Panthers. One was by Huey P. Newton in the late 1980s. And then Holder's dissertation from UMass, I think, was done in 1990, 1991. But then you have a strategy of a revolutionary party. And I'm not sure that Oakland was revolutionary after like 67 or 68, but the Harlem Panthers were revolutionary. But both the West Coast and the East Coast provided for people, the breakfast programs, literacy programs, medical programs. But the Harlem branch understood that to be an extension of revolutionary struggle, not just self-defense. And so that is where we, in precarities, we talk about our risk, we talk about the possibilities, talk about our history, about our lineage. And that sort of sets the ground or the foundation for the podcast, which you participated in as well, of course. So it's a collective book that follows in the other two segments of the book.
Thank you so much, Dr. James. You speak of revolutionary love. You call it a self-acknowledged vulnerability. You also say revolutionary lovers are a distinct minority. Can you break open these concepts a little bit more?
Right. Well, there's the preface that comes first, right? And when I write about Oshun, and that's recent and original writing. I don't know what original writing is. I think it's all a collective flow. So let's start with the preface, Oshun's flight. So Oshun is a deity, one of the Orisha in the African religions that survived the Middle Passage, right? And they mutated into Santeria, a different form of Yoruba in the Americas, which is, you know, going to be distinct in some ways from the religions as they're practiced on the African continent. And then they're going to be altered as well, because you have missionaries and Christianity and you have Islam, right? There's so many different mutations. There's so many interventions, or you could call them invasions. But what I knew as a graduate student from, we called her my madrina in the South Bronx, right? That I could leave, you know, studying Grandissa or Hegel or Marx or trying to write on Hannah Arendt, and I could go to the South Bronx and be in another culture, same world, but different cultures. And so alternate worlds, like within a universe. And there I learned about the Orisha, and that everything you learn in a book is not everything that exists in terms of knowledge. And then you understand how to pray, not just to a Black, brown revolutionary or Black Jew, you know, who's a political prisoner who gets crucified on a cross, right? In redemption in terms of love. But you learn how to understand the balance of cultures and religions around the world, particularly African cultures, right? And so she introduces me to the Orisha, Yemaya, who oversees the oceans, as well as Oshun, who's the title in the title of this preface. And Oshun is the deity or the goddess of the rivers and the streams. And we all know how important water is, but we also know from Flint, Michigan to other places, how poisoned it is, you know, by these industries and extraction and the devastation of our environments. So Oshun's flight is that she notes that the greater deity, Olodumare, is displeased, that's to put it mildly, about attempted coup by the other Orisha. And Oshun is not going to be a participant in the rebellion against the order of things that works with nature. But Olodumare dries up the waters. And so humans and animals, plant life form are beginning to die. I mean, it's just parched or it's poisoned, right? There's no water or the water's bad. So she takes a torturous flight to the heavens. And she's known as for her beauty as the Orisha of beauty and waters, right? So water itself has its own beauty. But she arrives to petition Olodumare, the greater or, you know, the greatest deity. And she arrives with her peacock-like feathers burnt off, that she has the appearance of a vulture, a gray, you know, ashen vulture, right? The beauty's gone. But the devotion is there. And she makes the petition for the waters to be returned. And Olodumare understands the sacrifice, that she risked her individual entity. And the way I write it, it's like it's an analogy or metaphor to the resistance of capitalism, of imperialism, of sex trafficking, of rape, of devastation, of mass incarceration, political incarceration, ICE camps, right? And so Oshun's expression of love, the deity of love and also the deity of beauty, is motivated by what we, the mass, give her and give ourselves, which is forms of love. And so the revolutionary love comes with risk. It comes with sacrifice, but it's not an empty gesture. It is in fact fueled by love. And so when Olodumare releases the rain and the waters, that is when we have environments again that are inhabitable. And that is when she returns to the people or the mass or the animal or plant life that gave her forms of devotion so that she could risk her own entity in order to bring back what is necessary. And so that becomes actually a meditation for the book. The cover of the book has an image of an Oshun fan from over a century ago. I believe it's from Nigeria. I note in the preface that there is some irritation, if not distress, but irritation that we had to pay to get access to the image of our own culture that was stolen by Europeans and then put it in a museum. And then they charge you a couple hundred dollars to put Oshun's fan on the cover of your book. And so the irony does not escape me, but it is not distressing because I understand that we can be devoted to ourselves and to the environments that we need to maintain our stability, our sanity, and to move forward in terms of changing the worlds that we need to live in.
Thank you, Dr. James, for breaking open that metaphor. Didn't the name of that image also have a mechanical museum file name too, instead of Oshun?
Yeah, it does. Its name. I don't have, unfortunately, it's not right in front of me. I haven't opened the page, but yeah, it's a European name. It looks like it's French. It's like their possession. And it was, you know, someone went on some safari or collector thing over a century or so ago, and there was capture. And I think it becomes like this is the interesting challenge that it puts before us. How do we get our culture back from the museum effect and from the, you know, the glass case, from the docent and the tours, right? How do we get our culture out of commodity culture? And I don't think it's just about the fan. I think it's about our revolutionary culture, particularly Black revolutionary culture. Like you can get a hoodie or a t-shirt with, a panther, your iconic panther on it. You can be somebody's daughter, so on and so forth. But for me, that is imagery that is stamped like the cover of the book it is not necessarily a connection to revolutionary struggle itself. And so I used the fan of Oshun because I'm trying to be faithful to actually a religious tradition that I'm not fully invested in, because I also was a seminarian. But I'm trying to acknowledge that what we've inherited over centuries, even if it's been captured or stolen, that we can restore some vestiges of what is virtuous and what is true. But that's not just about Oshun. That is also about our resistance movements. So just as she, her fan becomes like embedded in a glass case in a museum that they'll, you know, allow you to reprint on your book if you pay them a certain fee, I would argue that Black revolutionary culture from the 1960s, and, you know, again, I'm co-authoring with Kim Holder, who was a Panther in the Harlem Party. And so I learn a lot from talking to people who are actually active as Panthers and revolutionaries, right? So it's a recovery. And I guess maybe this is what the book is attempting to do in those essays that start in part one and in the conversations, again, that you participate in parts two and three. We're trying to recover who we are in relationship to our culture, but also in our relationship and to our desire to not be captured, right? Or put in resin or put behind a glass case. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And when you're looking at the news and they talk about looting and all of these things, they're always talking about protest movements and never talking about museums. And it just, that's what reminded me what you were talking about too, about recovery and how the state just steals and causes violence without any repercussions.
Yeah, it's sort of simultaneous. It's both, as you said, it's the museum and it's the street simultaneously. I mean, the state and the corporation want to control both zones. And so, you know, you have a movement and we're going to redirect it back into a nonprofit or back into the museum or back into the classroom. But the autonomy of living culture that comes from the streets, that comes from resistance movements, right? Years ago, it's in the book, what you and I had in terms of conversation. We talk about the captive maternal in the various stages, from the first stage of conflicted caretaker to the last stage of a war resister. And I think when you're speaking, I think of, what is a young Peruvian's name? Tortuguito, who was killed in Cop City by the Atlanta police, right? As a force protector. We will always resist. And in different variations, different ethnicities, different classes, we will always resist. The question that I have is how that we can strategically resist in a more collective fashion and anticipate the capture which the state and corporation and nonprofits engineer to quell or disappear our resistance movements.
Talking more about the captive maternal, you describe it as agender or non-gendered caretakers with diverse political agendas. I was wondering if you could open up this term more. And then you also mentioned in the book that there's a space that you hold inside for struggle, contradictions, and betrayals.
Yeah, so the captive maternal is a bit controversial for some people. I mean, when we were talking about it a couple of years ago, it's like nobody was really talking about it, right? And now increasingly, there's been more visibility. Some of it from the academy, like when I'm asked to be on a podcast with Cambridge or Oxford women, and they're predominantly white, right? And they're academics, of course, they're philosophers. And there's some blog piece where they're like, we're going to be talking about the captive maternal for the next 10 years. And I'm like, okay, that could work, but I don't know what that means for you to be talking about it unless you're also in alignment with the communities from which, at least in my mind, this term originates. So, you know, when we were talking about it a couple of years ago, I mentioned how I watch people hustle in Harlem. So I talked about being in Harlem when Erica Garner's leading those protests against her father's murder, and it moves from Staten Island to Manhattan and Brooklyn. I mean, the whole city is engulfed, right? And in these kinds of resistance declarations, and also stalling traffic, snarling up New York City. I mean, there's a lot of creative. The die-ins on the Staten Island street where Eric Garner was choked out. So for me, if I think about Erica Garner's development as a protester, it's just a first shock from having a private family that loses a loved one and then being politicized by that law. So you move from the conflicted or under-resourced caretaker. So you're always making compromises at your job. You take a job you don't want, they dishonor you, or you go to schools that are not really functional, or you get the scholarship. And so your kids can go to elite schools, but then they're learning different forms of classism and white supremacy and different forms of misogyny and sexual aggression, right? You're stuck in the zone on that first level because you just have to hustle through capitalism to stay employed, put food on the table. So you're always making compromise. Then you move to the second stage and you start protesting, like, this is corrupt. This is a lethal culture. It kills on a regular basis. You know, drone strikes in Africa, cops beating Tyre Nichols to death. I mean, we have a lot of examples, right? What went down in Atlanta, terrorist charges against forest protectors and so forth. And so your protests then become these movements. And we talk about 2020, the George Floyd, people flooding out in the streets, and that was real. Also, people might be coming out in the streets because they've been cooped up because of COVID. But we also know in 2022, the police have engaged in more killings than in, you know, any recent reasonable data. They don't really collect, you know, comprehensive data. So you have these protests and then they become movements, but the police forces are still predatory. And that's when we get to the last stage, which I call the marinage. And then that flows into the war resistor, because to believe that we can have autonomy without resistance is a false belief. I mean, this is what Holder writes in references when we're on another podcast. I think it's Millennials Are Killing Capitalism. He talks about being in the Panthers, but he also talks about when Katrina happened and those faulty levees that were not built properly, based on what knowledge I know, by the Army Corps of Engineer. So Black people created autonomy, right? They met the crisis by, you know, creating marinage on the water. They took their boats out because poor Black people couldn't really get out of New Orleans, like out of the hurricane path, out of the faulty levees, and they would rescue them from their rooftops. But then the police would come out in their boats and they would order them to pull over, get on dry land, and they would shoot up the boats. And then the Black community would ask Holder, because they knew he'd been in the party, why would did they do that? We're rescuing our own people. They could do something else. And Holder says it's our autonomy that makes the state nervous, when we can provide for ourselves. That is why the destruction of the Panthers was tied to caretaking. It wasn't just the self-defense, is that they were feeding poor people of all ethnicities and races. They were doing literacy programs. The U.S. picked up its free breakfast, reduced breakfast program from the Panthers, right? The state wasn't taking care of its people. So we organized to take care of ourselves, but then the state gets nervous because that's a zone of autonomy. That's when you're moving from to marinage. That's when you realize you don't need the state. They're not giving you comprehensive health care. They're not giving you decent wages. They're not allowing you to feed your kids properly or even educate them properly. And with all this repressive legislation that's flooding through, or maybe it's trickling through a reactionary Supreme Court, you can see the trajectory of where we're going. We're going towards repression. So it's the love that makes us want to be as free as we can, but we understand we don't do that as individuals. We do that as collectives. And so the captive maternal is moving from the isolated, overworked, stressed out individual worker into the communal resistor. But it's the communal resistor that flags the police apparatus in terms of its intelligence agencies that says we might have a proto-revolutionary formation emerging, and so we'll need to squelch it. And I think that's in part what environmental activists have been attempting to do in the preservation of what is left of nature. And it's what workers have been trying to do. It's what we, you know, abolitionists or the most radical abolitionists on the ground, it's what the people inside, when they go on strike, they care for each other and they have to protect each other against the aggression of the guards. But what they're gesturing to, what they're porting us to, is the possibilities of our communities as we care, as we express revolutionary love, moving from the conflicted captor to those who have agency in those latter stages. Protest is not enough, neither is movement. There's a strategic organizing beyond these movements that raise our consciousness, also that increase our political will, what I call agape in the book, love as political will, to move us through stages that will produce what we need.
Thank you, Dr. James. Sorry, I was having trouble unmuting there.
That's okay.
It's really powerful what you said about autonomy without resistance. I know Malik Rahim helped start up the Common Ground Collective after Katrina when they were helping just start up autonomous zones. The thing about the autonomy without resisting, I was wondering if you could talk about how revolutionary love can work to escape co-optation and coercion from state and the nonprofit industrial complex, and some call it the academia industrial complex too, and how it can just really co-opt a lot of movements.
Yeah, I mean, we're under the regime of capitalism. And so, I mean, this is an empire. I mean, when at some point it's fading and it'll be a past empire. But right now, it has the power. I mean, its control over military formations, over drone strikes. It's if Eric Prince is allowed to have a private army after being a Navy SEAL, it's tacit permission to have mercenaries, armed militia. If Kyle Rittenhouse can shoot three people and kill two, you know, all white males, right? And walk, basically. I mean, it's a violent imperial zone. And so the violence is not just the bullets, right? Or being, you know, kicked to death or something, some horrific, or, you know, choked out for 8 minutes while you're calling for your mother. You know, if you're George Floyd, I mean, we could go on down the list. It would be all day and go into weeks, if not months. The violence is also about capture, how you could repackage a revolutionary movement and sell it back to the people as if opposition to the empire would be something that would allow you to become a millionaire, or what I call movement millionaire, or allow you to have, you know, tenure and get promoted to the highest ranks, you know. And I have my contradictions. I'm not a millionaire. I'm not rich, but I did get promoted through the ranks, like of elite universities and colleges. And I think initially because I probably was more of a liberal, and then over the years I became less of a liberal. So fill in the blank, right? And that had to do with my association with people who struggled on the ground, people who'd been incarcerated, people who resist it. And so I can't define revolutionary love with like a precision of science. And I say that in the book. And for me, it's a conversation. How do we know we love? Because we have emotional connections with other people. And usually we think that in terms of our personal partner or partners, or our children or our parents or our grandparents or our comrades, who are also our buddies or sisters and brothers, like in struggle. But agape as political will, love through political will, and this is coming from my seminary years, this is the highest form of love. You love people you don't like. You love people who are difficult to get along with, or they find you difficult to get along with, but you're devoted. And I got the language of devotion from Felicia Danau, who's done some fascinating work on Haiti. And now is at the University of Cincinnati. They just, you know, got their degree a year or so ago, and this is their first gig. But on Guerrilla Intellectual University, which was a bit of a podcast we were doing Monday mornings from 8 to 10 a.m. on Black Power Media, she came on a couple of weeks ago and began talking about the devotion of the rebel. And that's language that I rarely hear, but that's language that I want to hear more of. And I want to better comprehend it. When I say I'm not sure what revolutionary love looks like, but I've seen people, I've written people, and I've anthologized people. Marilyn Buck, Leonard Peltier, Mutulu Shakur, Mumia Abu-Jamal. Mumia, in fact, writes the afterword to In Pursuit of Revolutionary Love. Like, I've seen, and you've seen, people who risk their lives to struggle for the freedom of all people. That is a form of devotion. And the price they paid, 40-some years in prison or not even making it out of their 20s or teens. Bobby Hutton was 17 when the cops shot him, right? Fred Hampton was 21 in Chicago. Mark, you know, Clark, when they were killed, you know, December 4th, 1969. there are all these sacrifices, and they're not in vain. It's just how we remember them with devotion. If we turn them into a commodity, like, well, you're the topic of my next Hollywood film or my next documentary or my next book or my next, you know, publication in the journal, then I think we're standing on slippery slopes here, that we can slide into a market, and then we miss the devotion, and then we miss the humility, and we underestimate what it means to sacrifice in order to resist an empire.
Thank you, Dr. James. Kind of a next thing with agape is you talk about the importance of imagining and just imagination in general. And you also say imagining beyond the carceral state. I was wondering if you could talk about this importance of imagination with revolutionary love and also where you're seeing it right now.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm in Ann Arbor right at this conference that grad students are doing, which is about insurgencies. I gave a talk earlier today, but there have been these amazing panels by young people, like who were in Atlanta or they were in Spain or they were, I mean, just go around the globe, and they're looking at repression and they're trying to figure out their role in terms of their generation as young people in the world they've inherited. Because we did have these struggles, right? Post-World War II, decolonial struggles were going down. CIA was roaming around, like, you know, neutralizing, co-assassinating people. Patrice Lumumba, Che Guevara, you know, Cabral. I mean, we could do a list here like we do the list inside the U.S. We lost a lot of people. But the young people are like, well, we still are in the world and we've inherited this. So how does this work on a global international basis? So to go directly to your question, I mean, I find, actually, I said this in the keynote today when I was talking about the United Front against fascism. First, when Mao made that statement in 1941 to support the Soviet Union against the Nazis, right, in terms of their invasion. And he's making a global call, like we all have to resist and we all have to create these viable living states, to the 1969. So from 41 with Mao to 1969, the Black Panther Party in the West Coast, with the help of the CPUSA and the SDS, is doing a conference on the United Front of Fascism, right? To fast forward today, you know, Jason Stanley at Yale, looking at January 6th as a white philosopher, says this looks like it's proto-fascist. Robin Kelly, as a Black historian, looking at the book banning through DeSantis and other states, right, trying to block out the reality of history, the objective history, right, and into a false consciousness aligned with white nationalism. Or Bernie Sanders saying a couple of weeks ago, you know, an interview at CNN, that he's embarrassed to be Jewish because of the violence of the Netanyahu government, which has gone really right-wing, was always right-wing, but, you know, incredibly reactionary, and the violence against Palestinians. So I'm going the long way to answer your question. All three of those people are important. They're all speaking to fascism, and they're denouncing fascism, but they're not talking about the specificity of anti-Black violence as being one of the staples or one of the markers of when you do have a fascist regime. And so George Jackson would have argued that this is a fascist regime. So what I see today in the academy is a watering down of the war. Because if you declare they're fascists, that means there's a war going on. You can't have fascists who, like, are not lethal or potentially lethal. I mean, even if it's not the physical body, it'll be the intellectual body or the spiritual body. It'll be like harassing trans teens, or it'll be like putting women in prison if they, well, you know, reproductive rights are no longer universal rights in the U.S. But now thinking about, well, we could levy homicide charges against them if they terminate a pregnancy, or maybe the death penalty for the real far right. But, you know, the real far right inches towards the center. Right. And so what I think we need to do is to acknowledge that the material reality under which we struggle and try to stay alive and keep our communities alive, not just physically, but emotionally and intellectually, that we would have to agree that this looks like a war zone. And I find that the most popular writing does not say that. And so then I start to guess, well, am I off then? Am I reading this incorrectly? I mean, that's why I started with Jason Stanley from Yale, Robin Kelly from UCLA, Bernie Sanders from the Senate, because these are all legitimate, you know, sites that they radiate within. And so they have credibility. So they're using the same language, but we don't have the same analyses. I appreciate all their work, but the people I know in terms of people who were in underground or the people who fought against fascists, like, you know, survived the FBI or the NYPD shooting them up, they understood this to be a war zone. But I think that is not the language that can be used, not for the people who took the money in their nonprofits and not for the academics who want to stay employed. So there's some of us, you know, again, Felicia Danau, whole their dissertation, their study on Haiti is about the war, but it's the unspoken war. Like, if you believe there is a war, then we should publicly discuss it, but not just because the bell goes off in your specific area of nobody should breach the Capitol like that, or people should be able to read whatever book they need to read, or the Israelis need to change their policy, or we shouldn't give them $4 billion a year, which, you know, I mean, given the Biden policies, that's not going to happen. So we're not prepared, I think, for the violence that is arrayed against the rebels. And the majority of us are not rebels. The vast majority of people in the academy are not rebels. That's why we're in the academy and we have jobs. And the people in Congress and in the Senate and in the judiciary, they're not rebels either. So the most vulnerable people, the ones who take the most risk, but who change the trajectory of history towards the mass, those are the people who deserve our protections. But sometimes I feel we take their stories and we put them on, you blast, or we, you know, like, save this one, rescue this one, oh, this one just got out, let's do a podcast with them after 40 years in, you know, prison or whatever. Sometimes that's the presentation of the revolution in the past. So it's the museum effect. It is not the presentation of the desire for revolutionary struggle in this present moment.
Thank you. That was really deep. Yeah, one of my questions was, a political prisoner and journalist, Mumia Abu-Jamal, he wrote the afterword for the book. I was wondering if you could talk about your relationship with him and any new prospects on him being freed from prison.
Yeah, thank you so much for asking that. Okay, so Mumia wrote the afterword, but just to get the afterword out of prison was like a stealth campaign. So we had to go to prison radio, and there's an ally, a white radical ally who worked there, but they were also an attorney. So attorneys can get in prison inside, right? Like, even if they're not your defense attorney, they have that legal representation thing, part of the state apparatus. They have the JD. And so technically, by law, they get access. So we initially, however we mailed in the manuscript, it would be rejected. And so it eventually got walked in. And Mumia was able to look at the PDF to even write. And what they did was so generous. And Mumia talked a lot about love. And there's a campaign called Love Not Fear. And it spells fear, P-H-R-E-A-R, I think. And at first, I didn't understand it. I understood what I thought I understood about revolutionary love. But fear, I was like, you can't tell people not to be afraid. Or you can't, I mean, look at the violence arrayed against them, right? Particularly people who engage in resistance. Again, you know, Kyle Rittenhouse keeps flowing through my mind. Like, well, if that happens to white males, then you must know the kind of violence against indigenous, you know, against people of color, against black people, right? But anyway, the manuscript gets inside, and Mumia, even though he's been working with people for an evidentiary hearing, which means he would get a new trial, because the first trial was totally corrupt, and people have the documentation for it. But his generosity is that he took time. We were able to get it inside, and then we had to figure out ways to get his writing out. And so this is part of the way in which the prisons, as you know, try to break your spirit. It's not just that you're held in cages, it's that your access to communities, diverse communities, to communication, and to intellectualism, to love, and, you know, just emotional connectors and intelligence, that this the state and the prison try to sever that as well. But he writes that it's Harriet Tubman. Like, for me, it would be Ida B. Wells. Like, we have these different ancestors, right? But he thinks about Harriet Tubman, and he writes about her and her revolutionary love and her revolutionary contributions, right? And then the irony for me later, which is not in the book, is the CIA put a statue of Harriet Tubman in their quad and saying, and claimed her as their first spy. And for me, that's like the dishonor of spitting on you after they captured your revolutionary culture, because Tubman is a Black liberator and the CIA was assassinating Black liberators, right? Not just in Africa, you know, Patrice Lumumba, I mentioned Cabral, but also one of Malcolm's daughters now with Ben Crump, the civil rights attorney, you know, who works with different families. I think I might have mentioned this before, but they're suing not just the NYPD for monetary settlement, not just the FBI, but also the CIA, is all being in collusion of Malcolm's assassination. And so they have a, I think it's a $100 million lawsuit that they put on the table. So this connects to Mumia, because Mumia is a revolutionary and he's incredibly loving and he's helped so many people with his writing. But the violence of the state that's arrayed against him no longer wears the face of a white male Republican. The judge that's been blocking his evidentiary hearing is a Black woman. And a friend of mine went and sat in the court a couple of months ago when the first round of hearings happened and said, you know, everything was put together, the hair, the braids, the nails, like, and just this sort of warm greeting of all the, what I'll call social prisoners. Hi, I told you not to do that. I see you're back. You could get 18 months, but I'll just give you 12. Like, I'm paraphrasing, right? That I would call it fake care, but maybe it's real care. I don't know, but she's an extension of the state. But when Mumia appears with his attorneys, that's when the hostility just flares up. And that makes me think that writ large, Americans are anti-radical. And so now I have to rethink the Black vanguard. I believe that Mumia is part of it, but I won't ever say, not now, that Black feminists or Black women in charge, that's an automatic progressive, you know, event. Looks like Kamala Harris becoming VP. It's not. And so now, how do we amplify Mumia's voice? I mean, we've written things being very nice to the Black woman judge, but saying, like, you've gone public about your grandfather was lynched and then your family's in poverty. Well, this is a legal lynching. Can we, like, talk about this? Can we? It's the petitioning, and I would call it like stage two polite protest, you know, on the captive maternal, you know, spectrum. And I'm disciplined, so I do what people ask me to do, but, you know, if he does not get the evidentiary hearing to look at evidence that was suppressed by not Krasner, but the prosecutor before, they had thousands of pages that shows that witnesses lied, you know, perjured themselves to say he was there, that he did the shooting. All that material got recovered. And now that's legitimate grounds for a new trial. But again, I feel if he was a white male conservative judge, we would have these protests like 24/7. There are these protests, but there's something about, well, the person looks like us. We can negotiate something. And I don't think we could negotiate anything with Obama. So I don't see why we think we could do that with anybody else in the state apparatus. But Mumia is strong. He's beautiful. He's giving. He also lost his wife of 40 years a couple of months ago. And this is what I mean about our connectedness. I mean, I've written to him over the years. I've put him in some of the anthologies I hope were useful. He is not one of the people I've been able to visit. I've visited political prisoners inside, but he was not one of them. But I feel that there is a connection, and I will call it love or care or devotion, because he stands for something greater than the individual Mumia. He stands for our vision of what it would be like to be a free and peaceful people who are not hunted.
Thank you, Dr. Jones, for telling that story, telling more about Mumia, and his afterword is wonderful, and hope he can be free soon, and I hope he can stay healthy. So thank you.
Yeah, if you want to, you could, they have a a collective. It's called Love Not Fear, P-H-R-E-A-R. And Julia Wright, who is the daughter of Richard Wright, the novelist, she's helped heading that. And so if you go online, you could sign a petition to Judge Clements, that's her name, and they want everybody to be respectful, of course, and just ask her to do the right thing in terms of the facts, not in terms of what the Philly cops want, you know, who are pretty egregious in their violence against civilians, or the need to not embarrass a prosecutor that put Abu-Jamal, you know, and kept him there. It was decades of prosecutors, right? In prison for the death of Faulkner, the police officer who was also shot when Mumia was shot on that street in Philadelphia. And Faulkner, of course, was deceased or died from his injuries.
But did anyone think of any questions? Yeah, Bruce.
The performance of Revolution and how it have the potential to become a museum? Of Revolution, and I was wondering what your thoughts were on the documentary Who Killed Malcolm X, seeing as how the documentary led to the exoneration of the people who were falsely accused of the assassination of Malcolm X, and like some of those court documents that were revealed during those trials have allowed for the lawsuit that's currently taking place with the family of Malcolm X. And so I guess to try and concentrate the question, do you believe that that performance aspect of Revolution, if given enough intentionality, can lead to real change? Or is that something that should be more steered away from?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, because people want visibility. And I can't speak for the political prisoners, the ones coming out, but I can tell you, I don't think they have consensus on that. I mean, you can ask me as an academic who organizes when she can. The people who really know would be the people who did all those years inside and were tortured, right? And who fought. But there's no consensus. And I think, yeah, I want to stay with that for a moment because I can be really critical of other people, right? And as well as critique myself. We want the visibility, but then I wonder if with the visibility comes capture, right? So, yes, this is how you can get $100 million through Ben Crump, who in some ways reminds me of Al Sharpton. And, you know, like I'm old enough to remember when Sharpton was working with people that nobody would be working with if you were radical or really trying to change the system, right? But when Obama comes to office, it's not like somebody in the NAACP or an attorney who has chops or any defense attorney, the Abolition Law Center. Who does he invite to the White House as his spokesperson for the Black left or the Black streets? It's Sharpton, who used to report to the FBI back in the day. So this is what I mean by capture. I'm not saying that we don't make gains, but I feel like those gains are directed and somehow it ends up being a monetary system, which means we're turned back into capitalism. So the impact of families, you know, $6 million for, you know, the Tamir Rice family, $20 million for Breonna Taylor family. I don't remember how much George Floyd family. They're monetizing suffering and death. And so that's a direct payment to the family. But then you get the payout to the nonprofits. Like all that money floods in. There was money before, but after 2020, it's tons of money. And there's like the guy who runs Amazon, I've blocked out his name because I'm so pissed, Bezos, right? He gives $100 million to Van Jones, who's, you know, an abolitionist. But Van Jones is also rewriting the works of Jared Kushner to make Trump and Jared Kushner seem like they care about prison reform, which everybody knows that's not true. But what I know from people, there were liberal, progressive Black academics rewriting Obama administration stuff to make it look like he cared. He didn't care either. So when the money floods in and then the celebrities come in, I think of it as a form of capture. Like, I'm glad that Jay-Z did a documentary on Khalif Browder, who the cops, NYPD, put in Rikers saying he stole a backpack. And then they said they didn't, but he kept him for like a couple years because his family couldn't afford bail. And like the police torture him. And then after he gets out, he goes to his mom's house. And after months or a year or so, he commits suicide. The money won't bring us back life. And if you keep killing us, your financial compensations is, for me, just another scheme of trafficking. It's just the money goes to individuals. Is there greater vulnerability? Absolutely. Like, I try to get my teens to watch Who Killed Malcolm. It's like, now I got to go listen to a rapper or something. And it's like, okay, I can't force you. But I do say that when I look at this documentary and what they tried to do in it, you understand that not only did Malcolm love us, but we love Malcolm. That's why somebody spent all that time to do research and pissed off Nation of Islam and in Newark Mosque number, whatever, you know, so we're complicated. But we, in my opinion, if they promote you, if they pay you, they believe they owe you, not owe you in terms of freedom, but they owe you leverage and higher visibility. But now you're in the marketplace. And then who gets to define what Black revolutionary struggle is or revolutionary love is? It's going to be shaped by the market and the people who run the market. So I'm not saying don't take the money. If, you know, somebody murdered one of mine, I would be pissed. I would take a settlement. Samira Rice said I took the settlement because I couldn't get an attorney. Who she said I had that we did an interview with her. It's on Williams College if you want to listen to it. I think I mentioned that February 8th. She's like, I went through six attorneys and they were saying that I needed to calm down because you couldn't be an angry Black woman and get real money. I just think dishonor comes with the money. I'm not saying don't take the money. I think dishonor comes with the visibility because now you're a friggin' commercial. They sell stuff with our death and our trauma. This is like, oh, you want to see Tyree Nichols get beaten to death on a street? Like, you're going to click. I don't watch that. It's porn. You know, so we're caught, as Sophia Bukhari said, we're caught between a rock and a hard place. We need visibility because we need to bring attention to our movements. But then if our movements are captured in a commodities market where they're just selling Black suffering or Black resistance, that visibility, I don't think is going to work for us. I think it's going to work for the state and the corporation. The most important, I really appreciate what you brought out because I'm realizing, I think the most important thing is that we be visible to ourselves, not rely on Netflix, not rely on CNN, not even rely on Democracy Now!, definitely not New York Times, Washington Post, or these academic, like explaining how not to be a racist. Like, go ahead and make the money, but we need to have our freedom schools. We need to have our conversations with each other. We need to have what you have, your autonomous bookstore, so that we can talk to each other without being on camera and without being reduced to a commodity, because we don't run the market. We just get sucked into it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. James. The question was about visibility and organizing. You've been organizing your workplace. And that really the crux of momentum in revolutionary movements and kind of momentum with revolutionary movement and building, like some maybe tips on that?
Yeah. Okay, well, I think we have different experiences, right? Like some of the people who are presenting at this conference, they talk about how they were driven out of the academy. And they're all different ethnicities, right? You know, Latino, white, Black. Again, I think I survived this long in part because the people I know, I would call them radical liberals. I'm sure they would say they were. But anyway, like some of the people I learned and trained, you know, they trained me in a formal way would be like Cornel West, my advisor in seminary, or like spending a year or so with Angela Davis, right, around organizing, around abolition. But I think white politics reflect more the non-celebrity people who are on the ground. But I'm a hybrid, like I'm in the middle between the two. What I'm trying to do now, like after my college, I'm sure they decided they were trying to do it. Let's just say allegedly, we're really happy to like allegedly take my research funds and mess with my pay and try to get me to be disciplined, et cetera, et cetera. But because I kept publishing and then people started to read me, you know, in Europe, you know, Europhile, like Cambridge, Oxford thing, it's not like, oh, you have a big name. And so do you want to be on this committee, or do you want to be on the Mellon Grant, or do you want to do X, Y, and Z? And I call the Mellon Grant George Floyd money, you know, blood money, right? Because a lot of money flooded not just to nonprofits or $100 million that Bezos gives to Van Jones, and Bezos also gives money to the cops. So like everybody's playing both sides. But that money from the nonprofits went to elite schools. So the grant I'm on right now, like they gave $5 million to Brown University, 4.9, and then Williams got like a 10% cut, 500K. And so since now I'm on it, then I invite Samaria Rice, or I invite Indigenous leaders. Our next roundtable is going to be on Indigenous pedagogy. I invited Frank Wilderson and Terefi to talk about the ontology of betrayal. I like Afro-pessimism. Some people hate it, some people don't. But Wilderson actually fought in Revolutionary Underground. He's the only academic I know who did that. So, you know, material world is a real world. So I try to siphon money off, or I bought a bunch of books. I'm going to try to buy more with my research funds, and then just make them available if incarcerated people want to read them, or the ANWO people. The African National Women's Organization is meeting in Ferguson in a couple of weeks, so I paid for books that could go there, right? So I think it's kind of like when you take resources from your office and you don't get caught, and you just like give them out to the community, or use them for people's school, or you know, take them to the folks under the bridge, you know, the whatever's left, you know, in the restaurant in terms of donuts when, you know, you're about to close. But that's not the same thing as a coordinated movement. And that's where I'm frustrated. So what I'm doing right now is, I'm probably messing up their name, is it Torto Guito, who was killed, the Peruvian, in Atlanta. So at this conference, their whole poster is the image is about a protest, which has a huge banner to honor their name, right? So I think they're non-binary. And so I just filled out all these postcards with the names of the people who got terrorist charges, at least the names that said they wanted people to write to them. So there's like about 8 to 10 people, but I've been told there were like 40 arrests. And since most of the people were out of state, like other people protested, but they only gave terrorism charges to the people from out of state because they want to look like you're outside provocateurs. So I know like local organizers who are tied to Spelman or just tied to the streets and deal, you know, resist the cops, that they're going to mobilize and support the Foresters as well. But, and I'm trying to answer the sister's question, but it would have been great. We talked about this last night at dinner. Some people disagree. It would have been great if we had had stronger connectors before they made that kind of move, meaning that you have to have stronger connectors in Atlanta, which is a Black city, if you're coming from Oregon, right? And so I would say that's true of academics who try to be helpful as well, that we have to have stronger connectors in the communities to see the first part is precarities, right? Where are your vulnerable points? Who's most likely to be arrested? Who's most likely to be fired from their job? And then as people like me who've got tenure, and now that you put me on these committees, it's kind of embarrassing if you try to get rid of me, then maybe I can do more or provide some resources. But again, that is not a comprehensive strategy. That's just like, we're just trying to minimize the pain and the violence. And I would say the majority of the people, I put their names on the postcards, they're mostly women. So I would just, you know, as I said, focus if you can have time on Mumia, but also check out what's going on in Atlanta. Because if the terrorism charges stick, because you're trying to build a people's garden and not allow it to be a military base, right? Then that's the state expanding the territory that it can control and the repression that it can levy against communities to show that this is a militarized society. I think we all do what we can, but I guess I would close with this, and I'm sorry I couldn't hear all of your queries. At this stage, I do believe in revolutionary love. I thought I wasn't quite sure, but I keep meeting people who are so devoted. Like the Peruvian was about like 28 or 29 years old and is now deceased. And the people facing terrorism charges, those are 20 to 40 year, or you stay in for life. They were so committed that people should have food, that you should have clean water, that you should have trees, that they risked everything. And so they deserve our protections. I just have to figure out what my contribution would be in terms of expressing revolutionary love, not as a sentiment and not just the book. And it's a collective book, so it's not even my book. Not in text, not in sentimentality, but in political will. And that means strategic organizing, fierce theory, and disciplining myself to love. So thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Dr. James. And rest will end it with a rest in peace to Tort and South Cop City. So thank you.
Stay well.
Thanks for tuning into this episode. Please check out Dr. James' new book, In Pursuit of Revolutionary Love. Thanks to Awareness for the music. See you next time.